Okay, so a really important skill when you're doing organic chemistry is being able to draw reaction mechanisms using curly arrows or curved arrows. And I've got five rules here to help you get through those without problems. The most important things about these rules is to keep them in mind while you're drawing your mechanisms, and perhaps to use them as a checklist after you've drawn your mechanism to see whether you've made any of the most common mistakes.
Okay, so you might be wondering, why would you want to understand mechanisms in organic chemistry? Well, I actually think it makes organic chemistry easier. You need to memorize less, and the exceptions to rules make sense. If you memorize every rule for every possible situation in organic chemistry, there's going to be thousands of rules, and there's going to be exceptions all over the place, and very little of it would make any sense. Mechanisms allow us to make sense of all these rules and exceptions, and really, I think it means you memorize less. When we look at mechanisms, one important thing to keep in mind is Occam's razor. So the simple way of thinking about Occam's razor is that in organic chemistry, a mechanism should be as simple as possible while explaining all of the available facts. So we don't put in extra steps when we don't need them, and so on. So when you're doing organic reaction mechanisms, it's really important to obey a few certain rules. So I've got five rules to ace organic chemistry reaction mechanisms. Rule number one is that every step of the mechanism, we should have either a unimolecular process or a bimolecular process. Unimolecular is when one molecule spontaneously a bond breaks and we get more than one component released. Bimolecular process is just the opposite of that. So we have two fragments coming together to make one new molecule. Now, two molecules colliding together to make a new molecule, going through some kind of energy barrier, that is perfectly okay. That happens. What doesn't happen to any appreciable extent is what are called termolecular reactions. So this is where we have three molecules or three entities all coming together at once to create a new molecule. And that just doesn't happen. The likelihood of three molecules or three subunits all coming together at the same time in the right sort of arrangement, and reacting to give one molecule, it just doesn't happen. Rule number two, in every step of our mechanism, we want to do energetically feasible reactions. And the energetically feasible reactions are the ones where weak bonds tend to break before strong bonds. Now, a general rule here is that bonds between electronegative elements, like oxygen, like bromine, chlorine, fluorine, when two electronegative elements are bonded together, that is generally going to be a weak bond. So an oxygen-oxygen bond, like in hydrogen peroxide, that's a weak bond and it can break to make two hydroxyl radicals. And you see in organic chemistry, this happens all the time. Nitrogen-nitrogen bonds will break, oxygen-oxygen bonds will break. So energetically feasible reactions are likely to occur where weak bonds tend to break before stronger bonds. Rule number three, curved arrows. They show the direction of electron flow, like a river. So the river starts off at a source. The source, in the case of curved arrows, is a pair of electrons, either from a lone pair or from a bond, remembering that a bond signifies a pair of electrons. And then that flows towards another atom to make a new bond. And then we can break an old bond and make the electrons flow towards another atom, perhaps this time making a new lone pair. And that lone pair might be associated with a charge as well, like a negative charge. So these double-headed arrows represent two electrons. And there's always a flow from an electron source through to some kind of eventual electron sink. We might draw just one curly arrow or curved arrow. We might draw two or three or more in a particular reaction. Rule number four, never draw five bonds to carbon. In fact, never draw five bonds to any of the main group elements in that first row. So that's boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine. None of those atoms like to disobey the octet rule. And the octet rule says they want to have eight electrons in their valence shell. Each bond represents two electrons, so five bonds represents 10 electrons, which is too much for the octet rule. So this breaks that desire for carbon and other first row elements to only have eight electrons in their valence shell. So a carbon with five bonds is colloquially known as a Texas carbon because it's a bit like the Texas star on the Texas flag. Lastly, rule number 5, never draw an arrow starting from a proton. Now, why is this the case? Well, a proton is a hydrogen atom. What's a hydrogen atom? It's just a proton. It's H plus is just a proton nucleide, no neutrons and no electrons around it. If there's no electrons around it and curved arrows signify the movement of electrons, we can't start a curved arrow from a H plus or a proton. So never draw an arrow starting from a proton.
Okay, I hope those 5 rules were helpful. Just keep them in mind when you're doing reaction mechanism problems and go back over your answer and see whether you've broken any of those rules or whether they're all in place. Good luck. Click the link above to subscribe and you'll be informed every time I put out a new organic chemistry video. Or click below this video to see interactive tutorials on my website, Organic Chemistry Explained.